first to prevent that revolution from vaulting and pushing itself too far to the left, certainly to socialism, and at all costs to try to avoid a civil war with the ruling classes of the old regime. And consequently, when that insurrection swept across Germany on the 9th and the 10th of November of 1918 and swept in its path away all of those historic monarchies of the German states, swept away even the monarchy of Germany itself, the abdication of the Kaiser on the 9th of November of 1918, and created a political vacuum, the Social Democratic Party moved very swiftly to fill that vacuum and consequently to preempt that revolution from the hands of those that might have pushed it further to the left, those organized forces and parties, the Independent Social Democratic Party, the revolutionary shop stewards, certainly the Spartacists, who might have thought that that revolutionary moment was the time, really, to put meaning to those words of socialism. And you see that the strategy of containment, or the strategy of normalization that the Social Democratic Party charted and operated for, was really a kind of masterpiece. It was a masterpiece of very cool calculation, a masterpiece of very quick decision. And neither calculation nor decision were the characteristics of those forces that wanted to move further to the left. In the first place, within 48 hours, by the end of the 10th of November of 1918, the Social Democratic Party had created and dominated the organs of the new government. And consequently, on the 10th of November was created what was called the Council of People's Commissars, which, in order to fob off the working classes of Berlin that were further to the left than that social democratic leadership, consisted of six members, three of whom were social democrats and three of whom were independent social democrats, giving it somewhat a more left-wing flair, but a council of people's commissars that said right from the very beginning that its aim was not to pass power over to the popular councils, to the people's councils that had mushroomed all across Germany, but at the earliest possible moment to convoke a constituent assembly and consequently set down the institutions of a new regime. Now that choice is critically important, because if you pass power to the councils, what it means is that you pass power to the predominant influence of the proletariat, and that you really do exclude the bourgeoisie and the petit bourgeoisie, which implies that you are going to socialism. Whereby, if you choose the constituent assembly, what it means is that you are giving vent to the play of all classes and of all parties, which implies that you will have, after all, a liberal democracy of the bourgeois style. And you see that the ruling classes understood this, and they understood how critical that choice was. And it's extremely interesting that with the swiftness of the bat of an eye, that the parties of the bourgeoisie suddenly became ardent partisans of democracy. They who had so vigorously opposed universal suffrage, who had opposed all of that moving toward democratic institutions, suddenly realized that bourgeois democracy was much the lesser of two evils. That if there were a universal suffrage republic, that they might very well be able to co-opt it. And consequently, a party like the National Liberal Party, which was under the presidency of a conservative politician like Gustav Stresemann, and which was heavily financed by Hugo Stinnes, the steel baron, and heavily financed by the industrialist Goldberg, that National Liberal Party changed its name to the German People's Party, and consequently declared itself to be a very ardent partisan of democracy, and why not? And the second part of that strategy, even more important, and that is that within 48 hours, Ebert, the head of the Social Democratic Party and the head of the government, had made his deals, whether formal or informal, whether verbal or nonverbal, with the high command of the army, with the bureaucracy of the old regime, and with the German industrialists. In other words, it was perfectly clear right from the beginning that the repressive power of the old state and that the property power of the capitalists would remain intact. which means that on the 10th of November, Hindenburg, the head of the German army, could wire to the army commanders and say, we support this regime, because this regime promises to keep order, which meant, after all, not only a bulwark against Bolshevism, as Hindenburg called it, but it meant, of course, that the army would have to be called upon to keep that order. In other words, that it would have a place in that new regime. And consequently, there was, quite obviously, an alliance of crucial importance with the bureaucracy. Ebert said right from the beginning that all of the old bureaucrats remained in their positions. And not only that, but the old ministers of the Hohenzollern Empire would remain in their positions. Dr. Saul would remain at Foreign Affairs. Von Schuch would remain at the War Office. Preuss would remain at Interior. Presumably, these bureaucrats and ministers were then to be overseered by the Council of People's Commissars, but you can well imagine what power they then disposed of in their hand. And as far as the industrialists are concerned, they knew already they had nothing real to fear. The Kushtinists had made his agreement with Le Guin on the 12th of November with the trade unions, in which the centerpiece was the eight-hour day, and certainly not any kind of real worker control in the factories, certainly not the nationalization of those factories. And it was perfectly clear when on the 12th of November of 1918, the provisional government issued a proclamation in which it detailed its aims. Its aims were workers' housing and the eight-hour day and civil liberties and the vote for women, all kinds of good liberal reforms, but which didn't threaten the property order. You see, the revolution was, from beginning to end, the change of a political regime and not a profound social revolution of the kind that the left-wing socialists had demanded. Well, was it a question of the socialization of the means of production? There were cries for it, you see, that came out of the councils of workers that had mushroomed in Berlin. And consequently, the Council of People's Commissars set up a commission on socialization in order to investigate the possibility of selective nationalization of the means of production. But in that commission are representatives of the trade unions and representatives of the employers. And the key voice is Walter Rathenau, the head of the Electrical Trust. And consequently, it was a commission to buy time. In other words, to form a commission and talk about the question while it was in the air until such time would pass that it no longer was a burning issue. Precisely the tactic that the British government always has used when there have been what they call troubles in the colonies, or when there have been massive insurrections, and then there's a parliamentary inquiry commission which reports back 4 years later, and consequently nobody remembers. And so it was with justification that Stinnis went before the Association of Iron and Steel Industrialists on the 14th of November and said, don't worry about the Commission on Socialization, it isn't going to do anything. But the third part of that strategy of normalization and stabilization is perhaps most important. And that is the capacity, and really an astonishing capacity, and you give credit to those, after all, who know how to maneuver politics. The capacity of the SPD, of the Social Democratic Party, to co-opt and to devitalize the councils. The councils really were people's power. These councils of workers, councils of soldiers, and so forth. And there was this incredible capacity of the SPD really to lay hand upon those councils. Because two facts operate and operate very centrally. One is the fact that there is, after all, a capacity of the SPD to split the workers and the soldiers' councils. That what they do is to get a primordial influence in the councils of soldiers. And that tactic was used on the very first day of the revolution very effectively. There was a social democrat who played a notable role named Otto Belz. And Belz is going to become the so-called military governor of the city of Berlin. He'll play an important part. And what Otto Belz did for the Social Democratic Party on the 9th of November was to go around to the barracks of soldiers, because what the SPD feared was that the soldiers weren't revolutionary and they would come out on the streets and they would be pushed to it by their officers and they would begin to shoot on the workers. They would shoot them down and consequently they would shoot the workers into the leftward direction, that they would push them into the arms of the Spartacists. And so those went around and found men of confidence in all of these barracks, people who would be the funnel of SPD influence, with the line of, look, there is a vacuum. You yourself form councils of soldiers, and consequently that will be a kind of counterweight to the radicalization of these Berlin workers. And consequently the SPD had among these soldiers some very weird kinds of men of confidence. A man with a strange English-sounding name, Colin Ross, who later ended up at the Hitler camp, a complete adventurer, or somebody like Otto Strobel, who published many anti-Semitic pamphlets in the 1920s. And these were soldiers doing the work of the SPD in these barracks, forming them into councils, and knowing that they would stand as a bulwark against these workers. Because you have to understand something important, and this differentiates the German Revolution from the Russian Revolution, and that is that the troops, after all, were not basically revolutionary troops. The army had never cracked in Germany. It had never corroded on the fronts. There had been very few mutinies, and consequently, these were troops that still were full of the chauvinistic propaganda that had been fed to them. And consequently, when they looked at these workers, when they heard the Spartacists, they thought that these were people who were stabbing Germany in the back, that these were people who had undermined their war effort, their beautiful victory, which they had been full of, and which their heads were full of, and which really was out of their reach and eluded them. And consequently, they formed councils, most interestingly, with their officers. Because, you see, the order went out from the high command, a secret order on the 16th of November, that read this way. Officers must create councils in the army in order to help the troops resist the extremists. And so what you get are these soldiers' councils that really are very susceptible to the propaganda of the bourgeois press, which is never censored, very susceptible to the propaganda of their officers, and certainly of the Social Democratic Party. That's one very important facet in that effort on the part of the SPD to control this council movement. The second thing is that it literally is a fact, and it cannot in any way be pushed aside. And that is that in the majority of the working class in Germany was with the SPD, and it was not with the revolutionary left. That there are certain very conspicuous sectors of a very avant-garde working class, a working class that really is revolutionary. That's in Berlin, it's in Stuttgart, it's in Leipzig, it's in part in Dresden, it's certainly in Chemnitz, but these are certain industrial cities. For the most part, in the smaller cities, the working class is with the SPD, because they are reformists. Lenin did underestimate that reformism of the Western working class. They did want improvement in their lives, and the vocabulary of the SPD really hit that particular aspiration of theirs. And consequently, within the large framework of workers' councils, the SPD anyway had a majority. In Berlin, however, they did not, by any stretch of the imagination, control the working class, which was much more independent social democrat or under the influence of the revolutionary shop stewards. And in those circumstances, it's sort of an act of genius when the SPD manages to co-opt the Berlin Council of Workers and Soldiers. Because you remember I told you toward the end of last hour that on the 10th of November was held a terrific assembly of all of the delegates of all of the councils of workers and soldiers that had cropped up in the city of Berlin. It had been called by Richard Müller and the revolutionary shop stewards. And what they called that assembly for was to see whether they would approve of this provisional government or not. Now, when that assembly met on the 10th of November, the Social Democrats really did control the soldiers in that assembly. And consequently, when Karl Liebknecht got up and he attacked this kind of provisional government with three SPD and three USPD, because he said you should never collaborate with those social democrats who have betrayed us in the war. And besides, they won't commit themselves to power for the Soviets or power for these councils. He was shouted down, and shouted down by the tumult of these soldiers. But even more important than that, that Berlin Council, which was really an analog, if you please, of the Petrograd Soviet, it would obviously be the most important council in Germany. And it would control not only the councils of Berlin, but in a way it would speak for the whole council movement. It elected an executive committee of 24, 12 soldiers who were obviously under SPD influence, and 12 workers' representatives. But under the impact of all of that noise from the soldiers, the rule was passed that among the worker delegates there should be parity, 6 SPD, 6 independents, which meant that the executive committee of even that part of it which represented the workers really had this predominant social democratic influence. Well, does that foreclose the revolution? Obviously not. Because from the opening days, there is a struggle that goes on between the provisional government, in other words, this Council of People's Commissars, dominated by the Social Democrats, and the Executive Committee of the Berlin Council. Now that sounds paradoxical, because I have just said that after all, the SPD controlled or dominated even that executive committee. But you must understand that these two institutions operate in a different atmosphere and in different circumstances. The provisional government is in the ministerial offices. It's away from the streets. It's away from the people. But the executive committee of the Berlin Council, which really is supposed to represent people's power, that has open meetings. It is constantly subject to the street, constantly subjected to the radicalization of the Berlin workers. And consequently, it's got to reflect that. And consequently, in the very first resolution that you get of that executive committee, which comes on the 10th of November of 1918, which is called the Address to the Laboring Masses of Germany, we read, "The old Germany is no more. Germany has become a socialist republic. They are the councils of workers and soldiers which hold power." There's not a thing in that proclamation about the convocation of a constituent assembly. And the struggle is perfectly evident, because Vorwärts, which is the daily of the Social Democratic Party, doesn't even print or publish that address to the working peoples, and instead insists that there will be the imminent and very quick call of a constituent assembly. Now, the struggle takes place immediately, and the first battle of it is lost within the first days of the revolution, and noted well. Because, you see, this council movement, and expressed through Berlin, either had to have its own armed workers, or it was doomed. And so the question rose about a Red Guard. Should, after all, the executive committee of the Berlin Council organize an armed guard? Should it organize an armed working class? And that was the position that was put by Ernst Dalvig. And Dalvig, a very, very courageous guy, a guy who himself had been a journalist, a kind of intellectual, who had served at one time in a strange peregrinations of people's careers in the French Foreign Legion, who came back to Germany and was in the SPD, then moved further to the left, one of the organizers of the Independent Social Democratic Party, very close to the revolutionary shop stewards. When he died in 1922, he was a communist. This is a guy that moved progressively to the left. He is a representative here of the revolutionary shop stewards, a representative of the independent social democratic left, and consequently, Dominic proposes on the 12th of November in the executive committee of the Berlin Council that there be an armed Red Guard. In other words, that the workers have their own army, and it is passed. At that point, the SPD moved into action, and they sent their men of confidence, like Cohen Rawls, like Strobel, into the various barracks, and they said to the soldiers, "Look, these people want to disarm you. They want to arm these civilians. They have no trust in you soldiers, and consequently, the soldiers raised a cacophony of protest against the fact that there should be armed workers. And they held a great assembly on the 14th of November of 1918, and Fritz Ebert, the head of the government, played it for all of it was worth, because Ebert went there on the 14th of November and said the following: why should we even think of arming the workers? The worker and the soldier, the bureaucrat and the bourgeois, all are behind the new government, and we have nothing to fear. You see what the line was. The line is that we have a national revolution and not a class revolution, and consequently we will not arm one part of our society. We will not arm the workers. The result was that within that framework of opposition, the Executive Committee of the Berlin Council overruled itself and reversed its decision. There would be no arming of the workers. Down they came back on the 16th of November with a second push. And that was the push to commit the Executive Committee of the Berlin Council to the rule of the councils and in opposition to the institutionalization of a bourgeois republic. It was all or nothing here, you see. Would it simply be a democratic republic in the fashion of the other capitalist states or not? Dalmey was out of his skull. He went on the 16th of November and he said, we've got to take our stand. And consequently, in his resolution, he said the following: the Executive Committee of the Berlin Council of Workers and Soldiers condemns the attempts of the German bourgeoisie to convoke, as quickly as possible, a constituent assembly, a stratagem to deprive the workers of the fruits of their revolution. In other words, say it clearly that we will not have this kind of democratic republic. Consequently, the response was heavy at that executive committee meeting on the 16th. And it was one Hermann Müller, who was the spokesman for the Social Democratic Party, and he responded to Dalmick this way, noting, well, Dalmick's proposal is anti-democratic because it would establish a proletarian dictatorship against the majority of the people. There it was. You would not precipitate the class struggle. You would simply not push toward a civil war in order to establish socialism. There would be no such process. That was the idea of the SPD. And Dalmick's proposal was defeated by a vote of 12 to 10. The Executive Committee of the Berlin Council would not even take its stand on that. The very fact that that happened aroused Gerhard Müller. Müller is a brave man, the heart and soul, after all, of the revolutionary shop stewards all through the war, who had played a notable part in the outbreak of the insurrection of November of 1918. And when that vote was taken against a republic of councils, he himself called it together a great meeting that was held in the Bush Circus on the 18th of November, and that was called together by the revolutionary shop stewards, who had a very strong influence among the Berlin workers. And this is Richard Müller at that Bush Circus on the 18th of November. If we convoke the Constituent Assembly now, we would kill off the councils. I have risked my life for the revolution, and I am ready to do it again. The National Assembly is the road to the rule of the bourgeoisie, and that road passes over my dead body. And Forbeck said, fine. And consequently, they always referred to him after that as Müller, the dead body. And consequently, the kind of contempt that the SPD press had, the kind of attack that they made upon those that were going to strangle democracy, those that were going to strangle universal suffrage, who didn't want the majority to have its say, all of that was orchestrated along with the bourgeois press. This is really what is so aggravating. If you read Forbes for that period, the literature and the language is very little different than the kinds of tracts that come out of what is called the anti-Bolshevik center, of which a Nazi before the war created, somebody called Edward Stockwell, who was a prisoner, who had been a prisoner of war in Russia, and who came back and got financing from a guy named Hilferin, Frick, who was head of the Deutsche Bank, to establish a so-called anti-Bolshevik center. And he turned out tracts in the tens of thousands of copies that called for the death of Red Rosa and so forth. And all of that was orchestrated along with this SPD attack upon those who were going to stifle universal suffrage and the Democratic Republic. The result was that within that atmosphere of the provisional government, that is the Council of People's Commissars, voted on the 25th of November of 1918, the actual date for the convocation of the assembly, or for the elections, I should say, the date was to be the 16th of February of 1919. And on that very same day, the 25th of November, there was a call by the Executive Committee of the Berlin Council, an assembly for the 16th of December of delegates from all of the workers' and soldiers' councils over Germany. In other words, the 16th of December, there finally would be an assembly of these councils, and they would determine which direction they wanted to take. But all of that, by that point, was futile. Rosa Luxemburg understood it very well. 5 days before that 16th of December meeting of the delegates of the councils from all over Germany, she wrote in Die Rote Fahne, the Red Flag, which was her newspaper of the Spartacists. She wrote this on the 11th of December of 1918, that, you see, when this assembly met, the Executive Committee of the Berlin Council was in no position to guide it, in no position to lead it to anything like a revolutionary goal. It is clear that it was in the councils that the masses came to life, but their own institution, the Executive Committee of the Berlin Councils, has been reduced to total impotence. It is now the sarcophagus of the revolution. In its passivity and indolence, the Executive Committee of the Berlin Council has played into the hands of the Ebert, Scheidemann clique. The result is that when that assembly, representing all of the councils of Germany, assembled on the 16th of December, the conclusion was really a foregone conclusion. There were 490 delegates, 390 of them were Social Democrats. 19 belonged to the Independents, and only 10 were Spartacists. And what could the Spartacists do? Well, take a page out of the French Revolution, and you organize the people on the street. You make a vote for one of those great journées, as they call it within the framework of French history, in which in the 1790s you constantly have the street mobilization. They break into the various assemblies. They turn the direction of it. It happens over and again. It's the great thing about the French Revolution. And so the Spartacists thought, all right, we do that. And with the revolutionary shop stewards, they organized on the day that this assembly of the representatives, the deputies of the councils of Germany met. On that very day, they organized an immense street demonstration in Berlin. About 250,000 demonstrated with placards saying all power to the councils. And finally, they got to the assembly hall where this particular assembly of deputies of the councils was meeting. And they sent a deputation into that assembly hall headed by a Spartacist named Paul Beyer. And he read out their demands. We demand the Socialist Republic, all power to the councils, purge of the administration, disarmament of the old army, immediate arming of the proletariat. Well, of course, that was accepted. It was put on the table. It wasn't discussed. And the crowd outside dispersed. It was not a great journée. There was no such force in the Berlin working class at that point, really, to force a change in direction, and certainly no infrastructure in the country for that. The result is that that very important meeting of the 16th of December came out as you would expect. The proposition was put to call for a constituent assembly, the date of the elections pushed up to the 19th of January of 1919, and that was passed by a vote of 400-50, which meant that half of the independent Social Democrats also voted. In other words, the Hase, the Dittmann, right-wing faction of the independents also voted with the SPD in this vote. Liebknecht was, of course, completely consternated. And he said that this assembly was a suicide club. That after all, delegates of these councils that had power in their hands, or should have had power in their hands, voting themselves, in a sense, out of existence. How to explain it? Well, you see, you explain it by the point at which the German Revolution had arrived at. Because, you see, the SPD, the Social Democratic Party, was a multi-level house. Everybody found a room in it. And consequently, for the ruling classes, it was perfectly clear that SPD was the lesser of two evils, that it would keep order and no other force on the left could. But then you think of these millions of individuals, of workers, for example, who didn't have very much political experience, or of demobilized troops who are very embittered, or of petty bourgeois who have suffered so much during the war and now are so frustrated by defeat, or of young people, especially young people looking for jobs and not having them. And for them, the Social Democratic Party offered the possibility of some amelioration in their lives. And they wanted it without all of that terrible expense and cost of some kind of civil war, of some kind of bloodshed. And you see, they were sold that bill of goods by the consensual spirit of the bourgeois parties, that they would participate in this. There was an illusion that there was a national revolution at work. And consequently, those that were talking otherwise and talking about socialism and keep the revolution going, they are dividers, they are splitters, they are people of chaos, and consequently, they must be condemned. So you ask, does the revolution go on? Can it go on from that point? And that question, after all, is hinged to those three questions that hang heavily over the events in Germany, the destiny of the German population in those months, December of 1918 and January of 1919, which is, does a revolutionary left exist? Is it coherent? And does it know what it is supposed to do? In other words, does it think, for example, that it has now to settle down to a very long struggle, a long struggle in which it will finally convert to socialism the majority in the councils? Or will it feel that the moment is now, and that it has to bypass these councils, go over their heads, go into the streets, and pass power to the councils, which the councils say they don't want? Of course, there was a revolutionary left, and it was visible from the time of the November 9th revolution right through bloody week of January of 1919. And its core, its most visible core, the Spartacists. And the Spartacists who were still occupying the extreme left wing of the Independent Social Democratic Party. And if you use the criteria of Rosa Luxemburg and of Karl Liebknecht, then you must say that the Spartacists had a very clear idea of what that revolution of November of 1918 was about, what its shortcomings were, and what the tasks of revolutionaries were. Rosa Luxemburg said, right from the very beginning, that this November revolution is the first very small step in a revolutionary process, that it changed political forms, but it didn't change social structure. And that the Social Democratic Party, in trying to keep it at that point, was playing the game of the ruling class. And that the reason it could do that was because of the very befogged consciousness of the working classes, that their understanding was very unclear. And hence that it would take a long struggle. And she meant struggle. And she meant practice. And she meant action. That it would take that long process of revolutionary action to demystify the masses, to disabuse them of their reformism, of all of those capitalist social relationships in which they still accepted their inferiority. And she said this very brilliantly and poignantly toward the very end of her life, when she made up that program for the founding Congress of the German Communist Party, of the KPD, which met at the end of December of 1918. And we read in that text these words: government by the proletariat can only battle its way to complete clarity and readiness, step by step, through a long valley of sorrows, of bitter experience, of defeats and victories. Now, what did that mean for the Spartacists? What it meant in Rosa Luxemburg's terms was that the revolutionaries had to make contact with the mass.
They had to enlighten them. They had to clarify the stage of the revolution. They had to catalyze their collective mass action. In other words, they had to find the mass and they had to talk to them over a period of time, which meant that in that context, the Spartacists could not leave the Independent Social Democratic Party because that was a mass party and it was their way of making contact with the mass. Otherwise, the Spartacists would isolate themselves. And besides, most of the prestigious leaders of the revolutionary shop stewards, like Victor Müller, were also independents. And consequently, that gave the Spartacists a platform, a way of reaching those workers whom they were to enlighten. A very lucid reading and a lucid strategy. And yet it came up against three obstacles that it could not scale. And that tells a great deal about this German Revolution. And in not scaling those obstacles, the strategy collapsed. And one is that the Independent Social Democratic Party, the USPD, is not a coherent party. That it is divided very strictly and strongly into two factions. That there is a right-wing faction of Hase, of Dietmann, of Kautsky, who differ very little from the SPD, who really believe in a democratic republic at that stage of the German Revolution, whose quarrel with the SPD is over details, that they don't like such a close liaison with the high command of the army, and that they think the councils ought to play some role in a democratic republic. But these are all questions of nuance. And along with them is a left wing, a left wing of Richard Müller, of the shop stewards, or of Dauben, people of that sort, of Bedeburg. And they are very close to the Spartacists. And they want a republic of councils. And they want to move towards socialism. And you see what the problem is that was never resolved. That the only hope at that point for the German Revolution to continue in any kind of ineluctable progress towards socialism was to restructure the parties. That the right wing of the Independent Social Democratic Party would rejoin the SPD, and that there would be a genuine revolutionary party of its left wing, of the revolutionary shop stewards, and of the Spartacists. And the Spartacists never saw that properly. And by the time they really came about to thinking that there ought to be such a restructuring, their efforts were too feeble and too late. And so they never surmount that obstacle of not having a proper revolutionary party within which to work. And that is related to the second obstacle, and note it well. And it is really what happens to the base of Spartacism. There is an influx of new members. And these new members are the exaltés. They are the purists. They are the rebels. They are the révoltés. They are unemployed workers. They are demobilized troops. They are men, after all, who are anxious for that revolution tomorrow. Revolution on the cheap, revolution through the street. And these are the révoltés who hate parties, for whom the bureaucracies and the leaders of parties are always an obstacle to revolutionary change. They're magnetized by the Russian Revolution, and they say the Bolsheviks were right, they took power, but they ignore the fact that behind that taking of power was that very long and careful party building to get that revolutionary instrument. No, they don't see it. They see it only in terms of the seizure of power. And so Spartacism becomes identified through that rank and file with action. Action for its own sake. Action under any circumstances, almost at any time. Like that event of the 21st of November of 1918, Liebknecht had given a speech in the Potsdamer Platz. And he had made a very stirring speech. And he had said, we must work towards socialism. And after he was finished, somebody in the crowd said, yes, let's seize the police station. And release the political prisoners. Well, there were no political prisoners at the police commissariat. And furthermore, the chief of police in Berlin at that time was a man named Emil Eichhorn, whom I know because he plays a part later. And Eichhorn was the only chief official in Berlin at the time, who really was a left-winger, who was a left social democrat, independent, and who was close to the Spartacists and later became a communist. So they broke into the commissariat of police in Berlin. They killed three policemen, and consequently, of course, the press raged and said that these are anarchists, these are putschists, these are plunkists, these are dangerous terrorists. And Rosa Luxemburg threw up her hands. What can you do with this? She had already written on the 9th of November a letter, a very poignant letter to Talmai, her friend, in which she had said, one of our big problems is to turn revolte, to turn people in revolt into revolutionaries, still a problem. And then, after that event on the 21st of November, she talked about the irresponsibles in the Rotafana, and she wrote, the proletarian revolution will always have to reckon and to fight with this particular enemy who easily becomes a tool of the counter-revolution. That this kind of untoward and this kind of headless action, this kind of maneuvering, of firing, of shooting, of spitting, all of that is just revolt. A revolt. That, of course, is linked to the third obstacle. Because the third obstacle is that in some very peculiar way, Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht play into that. And that is that you're talking about magnificent militants who really are victims of a certain kind of self-delusion. The self-delusion that the revolution really is ineluctable, that its progress is ineluctable, that the mass will do it. There is that almost mystical faith in the mass. And that every action, after all, of the mass on the street is looked upon as a sign of some kind of radicalization, unless it is extremely and totally outside of any political context at all. It's Rosa Luxemburg, for example, looking at the strike movement at the beginning of December of 1918 and said, that's it! You see, when workers go out and strike, when they realize that their real conditions have not changed, that the property order has remained intact, that is different. The strike movement, she writes in the Rotafana on December 2nd, 1918, the strike movement, now unleashed, is proof that the proletarian revolution has crashed into the basic structure of society. The revolution returns to its basic roots. It pushes aside the props of the ministerial changes and resolutions and enters the stage on its own behalf. The dwarfs who carry on their little games at the head of the revolution will either be thrown off the stage, or they finally will learn to understand the colossal scale of the historical drama in which they are now participating. And so Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht, with that faith that somehow the revolution would go to the left. And what you had to do then was to draw the line very sharply with reformists and opportunists. You drew that line sharply in order to enlighten the mass. But listen, when you do that, when you are as vehement as Rosa Luxemburg, when you draw that line so sharply and you denounce social democrats from morning till night and you denounce the right wing of the independent social democratic party, don't you also, in your vehemence, cut yourself off from the masses who are with them? And don't you also spur up the adventurous elements in your own group to very mindless actions? Rosa Luxemburg was caught in that, and there's no denying it. Because you see, her vehemence about the Social Democratic Party, you know that, and you can understand that. She hated those social democratic leaders even before 1914. And she hated them then because she said that they had abused the real essence of Marxism. That they opposed everything like a revolutionary praxis in Marxism. But now she hated them for other reasons. That they were traitors. That they, after all, were counter-revolutionaries. That they were the ones that were doing the job of the system. That the ruling classes couldn't control the workers, but the SPD could. And so she hated them, and hated them yet for another reason. And that is that you cannot imagine the kind of hatred that was poured upon the Spartacists and the revolutionaries by those social democrats. that in their press day after day and in their brochure, they talked about those social democrats as though they were the pariahs of, about those Spartacists as though they were the pariahs of society, as though they were the real spoilers of the revolution, and they virtually called to a counterattack upon all of these elements of the left. So Rosa answered them. The answers are so terrific. But you have to think of what the effects of them are. She answers them on the 18th of November of 1918 in a text that really is quite brilliant. And the Social Democrats had always said that terror was the way of Spartacism. Here comes Spartacus and you have a terrorist, and consequently that is not civilized, it is barbaric. And Rosa answers and she says, nonsense. The reason you say that is that you are afraid of our ideas and you want to stop our movement. And she says it straight away. Whenever a window pane cracks on the pavement, or a tire bursts in the street, the Philistines at once look over their shoulders, their hair standing on end, and their face prickly with goose flesh, and they whisper, aha, here comes Spartacus. Behind these rumors, these ridiculous fantasies and shameless lies, there is a serious purpose. The whole thing is planned to create an atmosphere of pogrom and to shoot Spartacus politically in the back. They, the official Social Democrats, the Scheidemanns, the Aberts, the Otto Browns, deliberately misrepresent our socialist aims as banditry. They yell against butchers, murder, and similar rubbish, but they mean socialism. But the game won't succeed. Even if a momentary return of the counter-revolutionary wave should throw us back into those prisons which we have only just left, the iron course of revolution cannot be held up. Our voice will sound loud and clear, and the masses will understand us, and they will turn all the more fiercely against the propagandists of hate and of pogroms. And then she finishes up and she says, okay, you want it. Who are the terrorists? If workers occupy factories, are they the terrorists and not the employers who, after all, have imposed a daily terror by way of the assembly line and by way of exploitation? Or if there are those who have programmed this war for more than 4 years and they call others terrorists? Those who sent 1.5 million German men and boys to the slaughter without blinking an eye, those who supported with all the means at their disposal for more than 4 years the greatest bloodletting which history has ever experienced, they now scream hoarsely about terror, about the alleged monstrosities threatened by the dictatorship of the proletariat, but these gentlemen should look at their own history. And from that point on, she got angry. And consequently, the articles come day after day. On the 8th of December, she says, yes, the Social Democrats will win the laurels that have already been won by Thiel and Cavaillac and Gallifet, those men who were shot down and who left the workers in blood at the time of the Commune. And then on the 15th of December in the Rotofana, with a tremendous perspicacity, she says that Ebert and that government are playing the American card, that they are saying, bring us food and send us relief and send us supply and we will give you the head of the council's movement on a platter. And then it is, you see, that all gloves are off and she's saying, these are really the enemy. Now, why not? These were the people that were calling for her head and calling also for the stopping of the revolution. But you see, in politics, unfortunately, you cannot really speak just through your emotions as Rosa Luxemburg began to speak, because it really did have the dual effect, those articles of hers. First of all, of heating up her own rank and file, those Spartacists who really were so hell-bent on taking to the streets anyway. And secondly, it really did cut the Spartacists off from the masses who were with the SPD or who were with the Independent Social Democrats. And Rosa and Karl Liebknecht went further. And that is that they leveled their attack also upon the Independent Social Democratic Party. And they did it for good reason. They wanted clarity. Rosa knew perfectly well that a Dalmick or a Richard Miller were not the same as Kautsky and Hazel. But she wanted them to break, and break very clearly. And so her articles attacked that right wing, that Hazel wing of that Independent Party, with just as much vehemence. And then there is a conference of that independent social democratic party held in Berlin on the 15th of December, the day before the council meeting. And at that conference, Rosa Luxemburg gets up, and it's really a thought there. And it's a terrific peroration, and she says that those ministers who are independent social democrats must get out of that provisional government, that all power must go to the councils, and that there must be a congress of the independent social democratic party at once in order to decide on these questions. And she is voted down overwhelmingly. And at that point, the 15th of December, Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht and all of the other Spartacists decide that they've got to get out. That they've got to get out of that party and go it themselves. And they decide that at the worst possible time, when they really are isolated, when they have not made real contact with the mass, and when there was a possibility in some way of making that reconstruction of those parties with that left wing of the independents. There were some efforts. Once the German Communist Party had its founding congress at the end of December, as we'll say, there were negotiations with the revolutionary shop stewards. Let the revolutionary shop stewards come into this new Communist Party. But those negotiations broke down. The shop stewards wanted parity, and these Spartacists wouldn't give them parity of influence. The negotiations broke. So you have a revolutionary left. By the end of December, it founds a party, the German Communist Party. And that German Communist Party, which holds its conference between the 30th of December and the 1st of January of 1919, is held at a time of terrific social tension. The social tension had mounted all through the month of December. And the words of Karl Liebknecht, who becomes the head of that German Communist Party in 1920 and early 1921, and Karl Liebknecht, a very close friend of Rosa Luxemburg, described very well in July of 1920, before the Second World Congress of the Communist International, what the mood was, what the atmosphere was at the end of December of 1918. The air of Berlin was full of revolutionary tension. There was no one who didn't think big things were going to happen. The delegates who represented the volatile masses couldn't even conceive that their street action might end in defeat and total repression and not in revolution. You see what had happened. All through December, there had been growing attacks upon the Ebert government, growing economic strikes, and it all culminated in what was called Bloody Christmas of 1918. And that was the attack by the government on the so-called People's Naval Division. There was a big shed called the Marstall, which were the stables of the Royal Palace. And in the Marstall, there had come to be ensconced what was called the People's Naval Division. These were ex-sailors who had come down from the port of Kiel or had come from the other naval bases. And these sailors, for a period of time, without work, were used by Otto Wels and the government as kind of paid police in order to keep street order and so forth. But these sailors were left-wing, and they moved terrifically to the left, virtually to the point of Spartacism, until the government decided to get rid of these people. It's got to get them out of this royal stable. It's got to stop paying them daily wage. It cuts off their wage. It ousts them from the royal stables by the 25th of December. They fight back. There is a street battle. The battle goes on the 26th and the 27th of December. Several sailors are killed, and it completely brings the government into disrepute with rank-and-file workers of the Berlin working class. In fact, it was only with great help that the officers who were brought in to direct the slaughter of the sailors were prevented from being lynched. The 29th of December, the three independent social democratic ministers, the three members of the provisional government, have to resign. They have to resign under the demand of their own rank and file. That very day, there is a great procession to the cemetery to bury the dead sailors, carrying placards that the SPD has shot down and murdered our comrades. That very same day, the government has organized a counter-revolutionary demonstration with placards that say, "Down with the Spartacists, they are the bloodletters of German society." It was all a setting for civil war. It's in that framework that the KPD, the German Communist Party, is founded. And it's founded, you see, with a tremendous adventurism at the base. Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht are surely there. And Rosa writes the platform. And Paul Levy, her trusted friend, goes before this Congress and says, look, we know that this constituent assembly that's going to be called is not our kind of revolution. But if it is called, we have to participate in the elections. We have to get our message across. This is a very long struggle. He is booed down. He is booed down because there will be boycott of these elections. No, no. Why go to elections if you can go to the streets? Rosa stands and tries to bring some sense into the whole thing. Here she's facing, in a sense, the product of her own vehemence. And she says on the 30th of December before this communist conference, listen to it. Some of us think that socialism will triumph in a fortnight. I would be overjoyed. But I am too serious to believe in fantasies. We have no right to repeat the error of the first phase of the revolution, that of the 9th of November. The error of believing that we make a revolution only by overthrowing the previous government. We must build a dual power out of the councils. We must build a movement out of constant economic confrontation with the capitalists. A single action will not do. We must conquer power at the base and not storm a single fortress on high. I don't know how long that may take. I only know that we must be clear and sure about what we are doing. And she is opposed by Otto Rulla, who represents the Sydney Convention and the Spartacist movement there. And Otto Rulla gets up and says, no, no, none of these elections. We now have other forums. The street is the fastest forum that we have ever had, and we won't give it up. But they never had the street. And it reminds me of those days, some years ago in the late 60s, when I paid a visit to a friend of mine in San Francisco who was full of the idea that the revolution was going to be tomorrow morning. We walked down the street and she says, San Francisco is fantastic. It's our first revolutionary city. She said, the streets belong to us. And it was just by sheer paradox that when she said that, we were passing the Bank of America, which was on the street. And so the idea of boycotting the elections, the idea of not setting up a structure, because no structure was really organized of this particular party, the idea of not really hammering out a hard and fast strategy, of saying what is to be done next, of doing any of those things that Lenin would have said were absolutely essential if you are to go out into battle, all of that didn't take place. But you see, in the opposition, there was not only a very clear idea and a very concerted direction, but there was also armed force. You're talking about a social democratic government which now has all six members of the provisional government since the resignation of the independents. And not only that, which has brought in on the 29th of December a strong man in Gustav Noske. That Noske, after all, who had been so very close to the high command of the army even before 1914, who hated Bolshevism and everything that he thought was connected to it with an almost pathological hatred. And this Noske had his armed force. And the armed force wasn't the regular army. The armed force was that so-called Free Corps, or the Freikorps, which was organized from the beginning of December of 1918 as an elite corps by certain army officers with very high pay for the members of that Freikorps, trained especially in street riots and suppressing them. And the 1st of January of 1919, it is Noske himself who reviews a parade of the Freikorps and says to Ebert, we have nothing to fear. This new German Communist Party, beginning of January of 1919, walked into a fated trap and ended that phase of the revolution. It began on the 1st of January of 1919, and the government was hell-bent on pushing the Spartacists and the left wing into a fated trap. And consequently, the issue that it chose was the issue of habeas corpus. Who was the chief of police. How in hell to have this chief of police who is almost a Spartacist? And consequently, it is said that you have to remove him. And so the government then declares that it wants Eichhorn out. He refuses to go. He says, I will not be removed except by the Berlin Council of Workers and Soldiers, and not by you, a provisional government that has no authority from the people. And so Eichhorn stays. The 4th of January, it is said that the government will oust him by force, and then a street demonstration is planned by the left. And consequently, the night of January 4th, it is the USPD, which calls for a great demonstration on the 5th of January, with no real purpose in mind, no real position that's hammered out. At the same time, the Spartacists decide that they will also call for this demonstration on the 5th of January. No, not to overthrow the Ebert government, that doesn't seem possible, but just to protest over the removal of Eichhorn. But you see, the 5th of January was fantastic. It was the biggest demonstration of the German Revolution. 500,000 turned out. And they turned out because they didn't like this repression, and because conditions were bad for them, and because the government was lying to them. And they went out in a great protest, and suddenly, for those on the left, it looked as though something really was possible. There were all of those people. Consequently, that night of the 5th of January, they organized a so-called revolutionary committee, a coalition of the USPD and of the revolutionary shop stewards and of the German Communist Party. And the three of them formed a so-called action committee. Ridiculous. An action committee of 52, which is no action committee at all, and which is deeply divided as to what it wants to do on the 6th of January and after. Do you overthrow Ebert? Do you establish a socialist regime? Or do you just make certain demands? And then comes the 6th of January, and it is not like the 5th. The numbers that come out are much smaller, and the will seems much less. There are no more than 10,000 that would go into any kind of action against the regime. And the USPD at that point says, we've got to pull back, we can't do anything, and here the German communists are called. They were not enthusiastic about this action in January of 1919, but their rank and file demanded it. Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht feel at this point there's no pulling back. The masses are out on the street. You can't stop a mass action once it begins. Well, yes, you can. Lenin did. But Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht said, no, we've got to go on with this. The 9th of January, this Braten, the Russian, who is in hiding in Berlin, who tells the German communists, it's not the Communist Party which dominates the councils, but the SPD and the independents. No question of taking power, you must pull back. They don't pull back. Meantime, Moscow makes his preparations. What he does is to ring in the city of Berlin with the Freikorps. Consequently, by the 13th of January of 1919, he is in full movement into the center of the city, slaughtering those street demonstrators right and left, wherever they move into the path of these troops. Well, the 11th of January, Rosa Luxemburg makes her admission of what had gone wrong. Noted that Rosa had never thought very much about parties. In one of her last articles in Der Rote Fahne, the 11th of January, which is sort of a testament about what she thinks about organization, the absence of leadership, the non-existence of a genuine organizing center for the Berlin working class can no longer last. If the revolution is ever to succeed, we must have an organism to guide and utilize the combative energies of the masses. She knew that the leadership wasn't there. She knew the organization wasn't there. Too late. But what for her to do, and what for Liebknecht to do? And Paul Levy went to both of them and he said, for God's sakes, don't go out on the streets. Don't you know you are dead ducks? That there is a demand for your head. They want to kill you. And Liebknecht, you go out on the street and you speak. Go into hiding. Get out of Berlin. It's only on the 13th of January that Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht go into hiding. Leave their apartments and they begin to live with assumed names and disguises. They don't go out. They write in the apartments of friends. They go to a different house every night. On the 14th of January, Noska had issued a report in which he said, order reigns in Berlin. The street demonstration is crushed. We have restored order. And Rosa writes in Der Rote Fahne, the last article she ever wrote, and it is called Order Reigns in Berlin. Yes, yes, the butcher Noska says that he has restored order, but it is the bourgeois order. It is the order of repression. It is the order of bloodshed. It is the disorder of people's lives. The revolution so far has brought us nothing but defeat. These are inevitable defeats and only stepping stones, one atop another, to the final victory. The leadership has failed. Nonetheless, the leadership can and must be rebuilt by the masses out of the masses. Order reigns in Berlin. The last written words of Rosa Luxemburg. Order reigns in Berlin. You stupid lackeys, your order is built on sand. Tomorrow the revolution will rear its head once more and announce to your horror amid the brass of trumpets, I was, I am, I always will be. The morning of the 15th of January of 1919, which is genuinely a day of infamy in any revolutionary history, at 9 o'clock in the morning, Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht were arrested in the apartment of a friend. And they were taken to the so-called Eden Hotel in the center of Berlin, which is where the Freikorps had its headquarters. And the entire procedure was orchestrated by one Colonel Pabst, who lived on to a ripe old age, and consequently who, when he gave an interview to Der Spiegel in 1962, said that in fact it had been orchestrated by the Freikorps, but with the full collaboration of Gustav Noske, the social democratic head of this entire armed operation. And so they were taken to the Eden Hotel and humiliated and bashed in and treated very badly and abused. And then they were taken down singly from the room in which they were being interrogated through the lobby of the Eden Hotel. Liebknecht first, in the hands of one sergeant named Runge, who, when he got Liebknecht outside the door of the hotel, bashed his head in with the butt of a gun. He was then dragged into an automobile, driven to the Tiergarten, there pushed out of the car and shot 12 times. And the story then passed out that he had been killed trying to escape. Rosa Luxemburg was taken down into the lobby and there, bloodily beaten. Was beaten and abused right in the lobby of the hotel, then dragged out unconscious into a car, taken then to the Lachwer Canal, where one Lieutenant Vogel shot her 6 times and dumped her into that canal, where the body sank and was not recovered until the 31st of May of 1919, totally disfigured and decomposed. The story went out that she had been dragged from the car by a mass of workers who hated her for destroying their revolution. And so on that 15th of January, Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht, incredible as it seems, were killed in the midst of a revolution that was one for which they had fought so very much. Not in the midst of the war, that would have been obvious, but in the midst of a revolution. So you see, there is a wall of blood that really came to separate revolutionaries from social democrats. The blood of Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht really became a wall, and it never has been penetrated. And that assassination was viewed by Philip Scheidemann in his memoirs, speaking as a good as payday guy, as the product of their own excesses, that they had brought it upon themselves. Well, you do bring things upon yourself with excess, there is no doubt about it, because there is that kind of infernal machine in history. But Rosa's last words are still damnably good last words from that point of view. I was, I am, I always will be, and damn, she is, and was, and always will be.